Wonderful. Thank you, praise and worship team. Good morning, everybody. Happy Palm Sunday. That's why you're here, right? We're here to worship the Lord our God. Amen. And we shall. We shall. Like that day so many years ago when Jesus entered into Jerusalem, the people came out. What do you know? They came out in droves, right? They came out to see Jesus. Amen. Is anybody here today? Am I the only guy in the house? Anybody else out there going to say something to me? They came to see Jesus and they shouted out in the streets. They said, thank you, Pastor Phil. You're the only guy in the house. They said, Hosanna, Son of David, King of Kings. Amen. Amen. Do I have to warm you up for another minute? We're going to stay longer. All right, everybody. Praise God. You know, I feel like the house is full today. I really do. I feel a certain fullness in the house. I pray that from time to time when you enter this house or when you're in this house, I pray you see the glory of God.
Amen.
I pray you see something that's not human, that's not natural. I pray that once in a while you open up your eyes and you see the glory cloud that's in the house. You know, I pray that you feel the presence of God. Amen. Amen. For this is his house. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing that this is the house of God? I'm amazed by it. Of course, you are the house of God, but we come together in this place. So we celebrate today. It's Palm Sunday. And, you know, I go around the room just a little bit just to acknowledge the family, acknowledge the presence of those who have come. Let's see. Sarah, it's good to have you. It's good to have the family. Amen. God bless you. Juan, it's good to have you. Praise the Lord. What we got over there? Tony and Gary, we'll do some shout outs. Donald, God bless you, sir. Indra, God bless you. It's good to see everybody. Nancy, this is your second week back. God bless you. We welcome you to the house of God. A couple of names I won't mention. Some trouble in the front row here, in the middle row. Let's just pretend that they, let's go. Yeah. Okay, nothing but trouble there. Sister Bruni and Sister Erica, we welcome you in the name of the Lord. God bless you guys. They're part of our online family. And to see you in the house, that's a real treat. So we love you. We're glad you're here. Praise God. Well, everybody, you see your bulletins? Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't say hello to our online crew. Our online crew, good morning and God bless you this morning. You know, I love these bulletins, don't you? Just adds a little bit of zest to the day. I want to thank our brothers who diligently always make sure that our altar is decorated with the palms in the front and in the back. Thanks, guys. Praise God. Today, we do commemorate Palm Sunday. You know, Palm Sunday is the day that Jesus made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And the people shouted out, much better. Thank you for playing along. The people shouted out, Hosanna. Isn't that great? So, you know, we know that by the end of the week, that week, you know, Jesus rode in on a donkey, right? It was Sunday. And as he rode in, everyone came out to see him, you know? The crowds came out to see him and they laid down the palm branches, as you said, Sister Petrozello. The symbol of victory. Some of them didn't have a palm branch, so they took their coats off and they laid their coats down for the King of Kings. Amen. Amen. And they gave honor to him and they said, Hosanna, King of Kings. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
But what's interesting is that was the beginning of what we call Holy Week or Passion Week, if you will. And by the end of the week, Friday, it seemed like the same crowd came out in droves and the masses came, but they did not cry, Hosanna. They cried, crucify him, crucify him. Some of them dared to say, we have no king but Caesar. Isn't that amazing? This week is called the Passion Week. From Palm Sunday till next week, Pastor Phil, you're going to have to give us a little resurrection. I'm going to talk about the passion and the suffering. You're going to talk about the glory. But you see, this week is called Passion Week because it's filled with all kinds of emotion. You know, the Bible, it speaks a little bit about the life of Jesus, very little bit about his childhood. You know that? I think they mentioned him maybe once when he was 12 years old. They mentioned him again when he began his ministry at 30 years old. And then from 30 to 33 and a half, they have bits and stories. But the Passion Week, the last week of his life upon this earth, the scripture is filled with the detailed events of his life. Isn't that amazing? There's more detail in that one week than there is his entire life. And it's fitting that it's called Passion Week. And I think within that week, what's encapsulated in that week is the absolute passion that Jesus Christ had as he walked this earth. He lived this life with absolute passion. He loved people. Amen? Amen. And more than he loved people, he loved God. Amen? Amen. And therefore, I pray that that would be ignited in your hearts. I pray a love for God. Love people. I say, by all means, love people, but love God more. Amen. Amen. Love God more. Because he will never leave you. He will never fail you. He is the truest thing in your life that will ever be. I say, love God more. Amen. And that was Jesus. His life was filled with passion. But all kinds of passion. He praised God and he also, he celebrated life, but he also wept in regard to the conditions of humanity sometimes, right? He would stand outside Jerusalem and weep over the city of Jerusalem and say, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I would have gathered you in my arms, but you did not want me. You would not have me. And I wanted just to love you and to heal you. And his life was filled with passion. The life of Christ was filled with ups and downs. You know, they celebrated him as king on Sunday and crucified him as a criminal. My goodness, not even a week later. But Jesus celebrated life. He had passion. And as we talk about this just for a minute today, I think God wants to encourage you and validate you to go ahead and live your life with passion. Because passion doesn't mean you're happy all the time, and it doesn't mean you win all the time. You know, passion says sometimes you got a lot of energy to do something, and sometimes you do it right, and sometimes you use all that energy to do it wrong, right? Sometimes you got a lot of conviction for the right things, but sometimes you got a lot of convictions for the wrong things. But God says it's all right. Live with passion. Live with passion. Whatever you do, do it with all your heart. Whether you're worshiping God or acting like a fool, do it with all your heart. So some of you do it well, some better than others. But if you laugh and laugh, if you cry and cry, if you're rejoicing, rejoice. If you're angry, then be angry. If you're angry at heaven and you're angry at God, go ahead. You know, we talked on Friday night in our Bible study that this book is the greatest book ever given to this earth. This book has produced more wars, and it also has stopped more wars. This book has healed and united families, but it has divided families. This book has caused you to love and caused you to hate. It has caused you to embrace God and caused you to question God. And may it always be. May that book be alive. May it produce passion. My goodness, passion in your life. They say one of the greatest elements of a speaker when you engage people is just to get some kind of emotion out of them. And whatever kind of emotion, it don't matter. If they love you or if they hate you, it's equally as precious. Because you want to make something alive inside a person, you know? My conviction might be different from your conviction, but gosh darn it, live your conviction. Amen? Because I don't think life is all so much a matter of right and wrong. I think it's just a matter of different than following your heart, being true to you. Amen. Be true to you. Amen. And I think that didn't, and with this Palm Sunday and this Passion Week, I think God wants to validate our passion. He wants to validate our lives. I want to use that word validate because we need validation. Only God can validate me. Only God can validate you to say it's okay to be, you know, full of passion and wrong and being full of passion and right. It's okay. But don't forget the passion. Amen. And I think we see that in Passion Week. So let's take a look real close here. It says, in Holy Scripture, the Passion Week of Christ, it starts with Palm Sunday, and it ends on Black Saturday. And I'd like to take a look at this Passion Week. I want to see the Passion Week of Christ because I want you to see your life. I want you to see your life of passion. I want you to see the emotion of it. I want you to see the rawness of it. I want you to see the triumph of it. You know, because sometimes you live it and sometimes you hide it, right? But I think God wants to validate you. He wants to validate your life. He wants to validate your triumph. He wants to validate your tears. He wants to validate your failures, right? Was it Thomas Edison? What did he fail like 1,000 times? What'd you do, fail 1,000 times in creating the light bulb? And he said, I never failed. He said, I learned 999 ways it didn't work. Right? And sometimes I think about it, like during the week, I thought I failed once or twice. It's like, no, I didn't fail. I just learned two ways that it don't work. Never do that again. Amen. 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 So I think God is broadening us. You know, I think he's broadening us because as a church sometimes, and there's times for everything, there's time and a season for all things. You know, there's a time where God wants to exalt our divinity. And sometimes when we exalt our, maybe divinity is too strong a word for you. He wants to exalt our spirituality, your spiritual beings. And sometimes in the church house, you know, we want to deny, we think exalting our spirituality means we have to deny our humanity. And then you have to come to church and you have to make everybody think that you're sparkly clean and you're crystal clear. And you're not, and I'm not. I'm also flesh and blood. I soar in the heavens, but I also roll around in the dirt. Anybody else? Yeah. Yeah. And we come to church and sometimes we're taught to deny our humanity. And I think God is bringing us to a place where he wants to reconcile that. It's the reconciliation. No, you're both, everybody. So I want to see the Passion Week of Christ, but I also want you to see your lives. I want you to understand it. I want you to accept it. God wants you to accept it and see the end of it, if you will. So if you have your Bibles, let's just read a couple of aspects. Let's just go, and I got one comment in regard to the 7 days of Passion Week. So Matthew chapter 21, maybe we'll start. We'll go through the Passion Week in Matthew. So Matthew 21, and right there in Matthew 21, verse 9, let's read our verse of the day, if you will. Scripture says, and the crowds, forgive me guys, I want to tell you my translation because we all got different translations. This is English Standard Version. All right, so it says here that the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let's see. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred, saying, Who is this? And the crowds said, This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth. You know, Jesus was celebrated at times in his life. I think this might have been the greatest celebration he had as he had that triumphal entry. And I want us to say, in life, we also experience the same thing. There's lots of times in life where you're going to experience triumph and celebration. You ever have moments of triumph and celebration? Hopefully, I'm sure. We're humans. I know you have. Sometimes we forget them. But sometimes life is really good. It's to be celebrated. Whether that be a happy event in life, you know, whether it be a marriage or a birthday or some kind of celebration where friends and family gather together to acknowledge somebody. Isn't that a beautiful thing? I think it's a beautiful thing. I think we should take time in our lives to celebrate each other, to celebrate each other's moments and accomplishments, you know. Whether it be like retirement parties that you guys all do with Pepsi, man, I think it's a beautiful thing that you take time. You know, you spend your whole life and then you don't want to say goodbye, but you celebrate the people's accomplishments and what they've done in this earth. So with Christ, we see that, but I also want you to see that with you too. Life is filled with triumph and filled with celebration. And then sometimes, you know, we don't understand that, you know, sometimes you go from triumph to failure. But the first day of the week, it was Palm Sunday, and they said, one more time, they said, Hosanna. I'll try not to get you to say that again. But the second day of the week, Monday is the day, the infamous day, if you will, where Jesus went into the temple. And when he went into the temple, he saw, what did he see? He saw the money changers. He went into his father's house, which was to be called the house of prayer. And he said, you have turned my father's house into a house of business. And they were buying and selling, right? And it said that the zeal of God consumed Jesus. And what did he do? Man, he turned the tables. He threw the filthy lucre on the floor. Right? I love that. He threw it on the floor. It says he even made himself a certain kind of a whip, the audacity. And he started whipping and chasing them out of the house. Tell me that's not passion. Tell me that's not zeal. Some may say he was wrong and some may say he was right. It don't matter. It don't matter. He followed his heart. Amen. He lived with passion and zeal. Amen. Some of you need to. Some of you need to be released to live your heart, to shout if you want to shout, and cry if you want to cry, to stand up if you want to stand up, to sit down and be invisible if you want to sit down. You ever be in a certain room or situation where there's like a shout inside you or a jump and you felt good, you know? No, never? Well, sometimes, just sometimes when you're in the house of God, you know? But Jesus, he was a man of passion. And so are you. You're a person of passion. You're created that way. And when he chased them out, and sometimes there's times in life where you're supposed to celebrate and embrace, but sometimes there's things in life you need to chase some things out of your life with an absolute passion and zeal. And don't be afraid. Sometimes you reprimand yourself for being human. Like something happened in your life, and you got mad at a certain someone, and you threw them out the house. No one's ever thrown a family member out of the house, have you? If you haven't, you haven't lived. And I'm going to be kind to you. With all of the zeal of heaven, you throw them out of your house. With all the love that's in your heart, you throw them out. And then later, you know, you question yourself and you reprimand yourself. Oh, I don't know, Jesus was human. He was divine, but human. He said, well, maybe I was a little much on that one. Because I know you do that for you, don't you? Like, oh, I don't know. But it all works out, everybody. I want you to know it all works out. But such is the passion. Once again, it's living with the passion. It's embracing the fullness of who you are. Sometimes we don't embrace the fullness of who we are because we're told and we believe somewhere that we're supposed to reject who we fully are. You can reject who you are, but it doesn't change who you are. You ever try to deny certain aspects of your life? There's certain things in my life I try to deny it, but listen, that's who I am. That's just who I am. And if God wants to change it in time, it's in his hands. Right now, this is who I am. Can I get a witness from somebody else? Yeah, man. Some of you are quite passionate. And I think God wants to validate that. Praise God. That was Monday. What happened on Tuesday? Well, Tuesday, we're not going to read all these passages, but Tuesday, you know, I want to give you scriptures, the 23rd chapter. Let's look at, maybe we'll look at verse 13. Okay, let's see here. Verse 13, it says, okay, this is where Jesus started to speak to the hypocrites. He says in verse 13, but woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. What does he say after that? Hypocrites. And he goes on, he says this so many times, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. And he says, hypocrites. You go through that verse by verse. So it seems like on Tuesday, Jesus encounters the hypocrisy in life. And I want you to understand that that's your life and my life too. As you live this life, you will encounter the hypocrisy in life. Things that are not true, things that are not equal, you know. And God wants to show you that it's okay. There will be hypocrisies in life, and you will act and react, and it will cause you to develop your own convictions in life, because Jesus had a certain conviction. And he said something like, what was the first one? It says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. It says, for you shut the kingdom of heaven, and you shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. For you neither enter yourselves, nor allow those to enter, nor allow those who would enter go in. Next one. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, for you travel across sea and land to make a single proselyte. And when he becomes a proselyte, you make him twice as much as a child of hell as yourselves. He goes on and on, and he starts to draw his conclusions and his convictions that says, I know that life somehow accepts these things. But my heart says, I don't accept these truths. I don't accept these doctrines. I don't accept these belief systems. And he wants to draw out the hypocrisy. He wants to say, be true at least, you know. Like live the words that you at least speak. If you're going to speak it, live it. And I want us also to see that this draws absolute passion from Christ. There came a time in his life, sometimes, you know, you're just quiet about everything that goes on around you in life, and there's such hypocrisy and so on and so forth. But there's times in life where God wants you to come to a conclusion, perhaps name it, perhaps call it out, perhaps tell someone, no, we don't live like this, we don't believe in this, you know, because maybe someone else needs to hear that, maybe someone else believes that, but they're unsure, and they need someone else to believe like they believe, you know. You know, such as, you know, one of the quotes, I'll give you an example, of course, you know, Mother Teresa, where Mother Teresa says, you know, one of her greatest quotes, she says, I was called to be faithful in this life, not to be successful. And sometimes we get lost in the two when we think that God wants you to be rich and famous and successful and nonsense. But Mother Teresa, she went and lived with the poor and the sick her whole life in Calcutta. And she said, I was not called to be successful. I was called to be faithful. And such are all of you. God called you to be faithful in this life. And sometimes God, you know, we need to draw conclusions and come to decisions and say, why am I chasing success? I'm not supposed to chase success. I'm supposed to chase faithfulness. You know, this passage in Deuteronomy that says you're chasing money and you want this. Some of you are just chasing money. You're chasing your jobs. You're chasing your paycheck. You're chasing more and more, counting it. Never enough anyway. And Moses would say in Deuteronomy, why are you chasing money? Moses said this. Why are you chasing money? He says, if you will chase God, believe it or not, you want to hear something extraordinary? If you will chase God, money will chase you. Amen. Now, all you folks say, oh, that's nice. Amen. I like that. I'm following Jesus. Whatever gets you there. Whatever gets you there. But I love this part of the Passion where this is beautiful. Every day of the Passion is beautiful because Jesus, he started to call out the hypocrisy. And maybe there's some hypocrisy in your life that you need to call out. Maybe there's some hypocrisy in my life that I need to call out. You know, and to be true to yourself and to be true to your heart. And with absolute passion, I think God will bring us to a place where you start to draw your own convictions in life, because you must live by your convictions in this life. You cannot live what anyone else has said or told you. You must live by your own convictions. Whether you're all by yourself or there's an army with you, it don't matter. Live by your convictions, such as the Passion of Christ. So it seems as if on Wednesday, perhaps is one of the better known days, on Wednesday, that's the day that Jesus is betrayed by Judas. So, let's see, maybe we can read that passage together. Chapter 26, right there in Matthew, verse 14. This is the Passion Week of Christ. It's the most detailed events of his life, the last week of his life. So, the 14th verse, let's see how that starts. It says, then one of the 12, whose name was, what's his name, everybody? You know his name? Judas Iscariot. Yes, the infamous name that most know. Judas Iscariot. He went to the chief priests and said, what will you give me if I deliver him over to you? Really? He wanted money to betray the Christ. And they paid him. What did they pay him? I have no idea the value of 30 pieces of silver, but it is of no value. You know what he did with that 30 pieces of silver, right, Pastor? When he was smitten and stricken in his heart, he threw the money back at their feet and said, I have betrayed innocent blood. And he threw the money back. That 30 pieces of silver was nothing, but yet he still had to fulfill the law. That was his part to play, you know. That was his part to play. And he threw it and he said, I've betrayed innocent blood. And he went, as the story goes, and he hung himself upon a tree, right? But it says, and from that moment, Judas, he sought an opportunity to betray him. I want you to know something about the life of Jesus Christ. I want you to know about the passion of his life. It says one of the ones who was closest to him. It wasn't a stranger that betrayed Jesus. Because if a stranger betrayed Jesus, it wouldn't have affected him. But you know who's going to betray you in life? Yeah, probably the one closest to you. Because it's the plan of God that you need to experience a betrayal in some way. Or you will experience betrayal, but unless it comes from the one closest to you. So Jesus was man as much as he was as God. It had to hurt him. When he learned that just an hour before, 2 hours, they were having dinner, right? And he was feeding them, and he was calling them, my friends, I love you. I lay down my life for you. And just shortly later, the one he would lay down his life for would betray him unto death for nothing. And I know some of you have experienced that kind of betrayal in life. And I couldn't even begin to imagine how it cut you or how it caused you to feel. But Jesus says, this is your life, and Jesus lived it with you. Isn't that beautiful? That he lived it with you and for you and says it's going to be all right. Because it's human nature. Part of human nature is this betrayal. I'm sorry to say, but it's in us all. I mean, the God in us all is greater, but we have a human nature, you know. What was that one phrase? I forget, there was a phrase from a certain film, and it's like the quandary was, how could you betray this friend of yours? And he says, betray. He says, all men betray in a certain way, in a certain form. But I think what that betrayal does is it causes us to cry out to God. Because, you know, Jesus, he went to God. He went to God in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he cried out to his God, his Father, the one who would never betray him, who would never fail him, who would always love him. For I tell you something in life. In this life, there's many things. Almost all things are not true in this life. The only true thing in this world, in this life, is God. And I think God wants to show us that the only true thing in life is God. Just know it and be comforted by that. So, you know, Jesus is betrayed. It's the one close to him. So those of you who have experienced and who will experience this betrayal, you're allowed to feel what betrayal does. Betrayal will cause you to hate. Can I get a witness from some honest soul in the house? One honest person. It'll cause you to hate. It'll cause you to be angry. It'll cause you to, I don't even know the fullness of the emotion that could well up. But it's called the Passion Week, and your life is filled with passion, all kinds of passions, everybody. But it's going to turn out all right, as we know the end of the story. Thursday, what happened on Thursday? Thursday was the Last Supper. Thursday was when Jesus sat around with his disciples. I think there's a famous painting in regard to the Last Supper. The Da Vinci Last Supper, right? And Jesus sat with his disciples, and it was the Last Supper. But even, you know, there's many things to be said, but the one thing I would like to take note of is also on that Thursday, it's the day that Peter denied Jesus. Maybe we can turn there. The 26th chapter, take a look at that. And the 14th verse. Let's go down to the 33rd verse. Let's read 33 to 35. Because first it was Judas that betrayed him, but now his friends, all of his friends, deny him. So here in 33, Peter answered him, and he said, though they all fall away because of you, Peter, he said, I will never fall away. You ever get friends like that? I'm your only true, yeah, okay, Pop. I'm your only true friend in this life. Run, everybody, run. Run as far and as fast as you can run. I mean, we are Goombas, we are Paisans, we are tight, me and you. Anyway, and I'm not too sure about you. So, just me and you in this life, and you I'm not too sure about. So Jesus said to him, what did he say? He said, truly I tell you, this very night before the rooster crows, you will not deny me once or twice. You will deny me three times, big bad old Peter. You're going to run like a schoolgirl out of the garden, I bet you. As a matter of fact, it was a schoolgirl that unnerved him. Remember, the little girl by the fire says, weren't you one? And Peter started cursing and says, I do not know the man. He said, I do not know the man. Peter, who said, all may fail you, I will not fail you. And this was the biggest, baddest dude in the group. You would think it would comfort Jesus when the biggest guy says, I got your back. And then a little girl questions him, and the big bad dude, could you imagine that? Can you imagine that? A friend of yours like that, that says, I don't know him. I don't know the man. I don't know the man. Huh. It says that night, all of his friends, they just had dinner together. My goodness, they just had dinner. And they prayed and they loved and they embraced. And before the night was over, it says one of the disciples, he ran so hard and so fast, a soldier went to grab him, grabbed his garment. He left his garment behind, and he said he ran out of that garden naked. Such were some of you. I mean, they couldn't run from Christ harder or faster. How about that for passion? What does that do to a person? What does that do to a person? The only friends he had in this world, he had 12, and they all left him. How about that? You'll experience that. Some of you already have. But think nothing of it, because all men betray. All men betray. It's just human nature. Don't hate him for it. Matter of fact, God will use it to strengthen you, to help you. Amen? Amen. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. I think God causes them to betray you. He causes them to flee from you. So you know that the only true thing in your life is your God. He is the only one that will never fail you. He is the only one that will never deny you. You could be wrong as the day is long, and he would never deny you. He'll say, you're a fool in private, but in public, he says, that one's mine. That one's mine. In private, he's got to smack you on the mouth, but in public, that one's mine. He's the biggest, baddest dude in the room. Amen. And he says, I'm not going to deny you. Great, at least there's one. And Jesus knew that. He had the Father. He had the Father. I love the song that says on that day, it says he could have called 10,000 angels. Right, Pastor Phil, my brother. I could have called 10,000 angels. He could have called 10,000 angels. Peter took his puny sword and struck. He said, put your sword down, you fool. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. Yet he chose to die alone for you and for me. Amen. This is the passion of Christ. It's his life because it's your life. And God will bring you through this. Some of you have experienced things, and some things in life I only tell you what you already know. You experienced many times in life. Can I get an honest amen? Amen. Not just one time. You experienced many things from different people over different periods of time. Sometimes you're the betrayer. Anyone want to be honest with that one? Sometimes you're the betrayer. Sometimes you're the one who denies truth and friendship. Sometimes you're the one. But life is filled with all kinds of passions, but in the end, it's going to be okay. God wants to validate that. He wants to validate that. Because sometimes you're the betrayer, and you'll probably curse yourself for it, as did Judas. But what Jesus would say to Peter, after he denied him three times, he says to Peter, you're going to be all right. Can you imagine that? He says, when I come back, after they kill me, I'm going to come back. And he says, Peter, I'm going to restore you, and you're going to be the best friend I ever had. And he was. Peter loved Jesus so much that he gave up his own life for the work of Christ. See, God knows the hearts of man. He knows your heart. And sometimes you're the one who's betrayed, and sometimes you're the betrayer. And it's okay. It's part of your life. God could take a betrayer and turn you around. He'll make you the most loyal person on earth. Isn't that beautiful? He'll make you fearless where you'll actually defend someone to the death. What a beautiful thing. It's called passion, everybody. He wants you to experience it. You got to take the highs with the lows, though. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right. Okay, coming to an end here, guys. Friday. We're going to celebrate Good Friday this Friday. What's Good Friday? Good Friday is the day, the night that Jesus Christ hung upon a cross, right? We call it Good Friday. So Friday, let's turn there, chapter 27, verse 33. Oh, my goodness. It seems like the most description is given to the crucifixion of Jesus. I have my goodness, 13. I got so many chapters devoted to the agony of the cross. Because, you know, prior to the cross, there was betrayal, denial, there was trials and you know, so on and so forth. Beatings, right? Many beatings, and finally crucifixion. I guess when crucifixion came, if I finally said, finally, let's get this thing over with, man. Stop torturing me and get this thing over with. You ever experienced something like that in life? Stop torturing me. If you're going to kill me, kill me. So Jesus says, okay, I'll kill you. So this here, you know, 27, let's read verse 33. It says here, and when they came to a place called, what does that say? I can't hear you. Very good, very good. Golgotha. What does that mean? Place of the skull. When they came to Golgotha, which means, what does it mean again? Right here. Right here, between your ears. It says, they offered him wine to drink and so on and so forth. And it goes to tell you about the agonies of the cross. So when Jesus experienced finally that Good Friday, he was experiencing the agony and the struggle of death. Not only in this life will you experience the triumphal entry and wonderful celebration. Not only will you betray and be betrayed, there'll also come a time in your life where you experience the agony of the cross. You'll experience the agony and the struggle of death. And I think everybody in life will experience that. Sometimes you experience just a hard time in life, you know, and it's just really difficult to handle, and it lasts for a while. You ever go through some dark days that day turned into day, turned into day, and it's like, and this is what you see, the description of the agony and the struggle of death on the cross. And I love that, you know, we just said that he went to the place of Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And I say most of your struggle, most of your agony and anguish, because anguish is just terrible agony, terrible suffering. You know where most of your suffering is? It's in your head. It's between your ears. It's not necessarily with a person or a thing. It's the struggle that you face when you're alone in your car, when you're in your bed at night, when you wake up in the morning. I don't know when, but do you know what I'm talking about? And the only suffering that's experienced, or the greatest suffering I would say that's experienced, is your mind. It's your thoughts. It's your regrets. It's your doubts. It's your fears. It's, right? Come on now. It's just true. And it's not my brother Phil that's tormenting me, although in my life he has tormented me greatly. Greatly. I'm going to put emphasis on that. Greatly. He has damaged me, and I am damaged still. However, as much as a person may torment me, I can torment myself more. You too? Better. Such suffering. You know, you got to go to Golgotha, the place of the skull. And I thank God also, it's a place you have to go. You got to go there. So I think, once again, I want to give you, I believe God wants to give us validation to your tormented minds. It's supposed to be. Sometimes you think you're the only one that's tormented at night, tormented during the day. You're the only one with these torments in your mind and your thoughts. And it's like, no, we all have that. But God doesn't reprimand you for it. He validates it. You're supposed to. You're supposed to have that struggle, man. And it's real, and it hurts, right? And it lasts a while. But you're supposed to have it. And it wasn't your foolish behavior that brought you there, because we all have foolish behavior. And we all struggle over different things, right? I don't know what demons are in your head, but we all have different demons. And that struggle is real. And I know I always refer to Martin Luther. I just love the symbolisms of the original Martin Luther in the 1500s. You know, he was the leader of the Great Reformation. He set the people of God free from the captivity, the bondage, the slavery of religion, right? With the Catholic Church, they would start to, I'm not against the Catholic Church, I probably shouldn't have said that. But it was the religious ideas that was so corrupt. And Martin Luther said, no, we can't. And he broke away, because the Catholic Church ruled the world back then. And then Martin Luther, he was the first Protestant, right? The leader of the Reformation. But I know I've told you 1,000 times, you know, when you get older, you say the same stories over and over. We got no new stories. But during the day, he would fight for freedom. He would fight for the rights of so many. Did you see the movie where the young girl in his, you know, in his parish, the young girl, she hung herself? And after she hung herself, they were going to bury her in the church grounds. And the religious folks said, she can't be buried here. She's condemned to death, you know, an old teaching, if you kill yourself, you're condemned to hell and death. You can't bury her here. And Martin Luther went out with absolute passion and said, don't you dare touch that child. And he carried her in his arms, and he laid her in that place, and he buried her, and said, this girl was overwhelmed by agony, by stress. She was overwhelmed. And we should have been the ones to have saved her. We should have been the ones to have eased her pain. And he was filled with such passion for people. He loved people. He hated religion. He hated the bondages of religion. He didn't hate the church. He loved the church. He was the leader of the church. You understand the difference? But he hated the religion that would condemn an innocent person, a tormented person. And he was the defender of the weak and the defender of the poor. And he triumphed in that, and he had such passion. He didn't care what spiritual leader would come against him. He defied them all. But it says at night he would fight his demons. At night he would go to that place of Golgotha. I don't know what his demons were. History teaches us, I told you thousands of times, he would beat himself with chains, and people could hear him in his room fighting his demons at night, tormented, if you will. But in the day, he'd put on his priestly garment and he'd go and he would help the weak and the poor and the needy. Amazing, huh? God wants to validate your passion. I don't know what moves you during the day, and I don't know how you're moved at night. Some of you go to bed with a smile on your face, and some of you go to bed with tears in your eyes. But God says it's all part of the passion. He says whatever season you're in, embrace the season, because it does produce. Look at what it produced in Martin Luther's life. He gave freedom to the whole world. So don't be afraid of your tears and your conviction. Don't be afraid of your struggle, the torments of your mind, because somehow it's going to produce in you an empathy, a love for people. Amen, everybody. It's called the passion, everybody. It's called the passion. And of course, you know, let me just say lastly, you know, it was Black Saturday. And what happened on Black Saturday? I venture to say this. Everyone in this room has experienced Black Saturday. Black Saturday is the day that Jesus laid in the grave. He finally went through the struggles of death. You ever have struggles in life where you're all over the place, you're confused, you're angry, you're yelling, and you're just all over the place. But then you come to a place where it just took everything out of you, and then you come to a place of quietness. You don't even care about life anymore, right? And then Jesus sat in the dark grave quietly, because you come to a place of absolute death. You don't even care enough to fight anymore. You give up on life. I believe that Black Saturday is a place that all of us have experienced, where there's no more struggle. You don't care no more. And you just lay in that the pit of hell, and you lay in the pit of the grave, and as Jesus did. Is there any witness in the house? Have you been there?
Yep.
Just you, Eddie? I'm only playing with y'all. Because then there comes a place of quietness where you don't care no more. And Jesus wants to validate that. He wants to validate you. Like, it's okay, you're supposed to be there. There's times in your life where you don't care no more, and it's okay. It's meant to be. Where you're quiet, you no longer have a voice or a struggle or opinion. You just don't care. I don't care what happens. I don't care. But I think God wants to validate your passion. But sometimes you're screaming with all kinds of fury, and sometimes you don't have a scream left in you. Amen.
Amen.
It's the passion of Christ. It's your passion. It's your life. And I want to say that, listen, everybody, our lives, my life, your life, it's filled with passion. It's filled with struggle. I will say that of myself. Will you say that of yourself? It's filled with all kinds of passion and struggle. All week long, or all life long, if you will. Our lives are filled with, I would say, triumph and failure. We experience them both, right? Sometimes in the same week. Sometimes some of you in the same day. You experience both triumph and failure. Our lives are filled with loving life. Sometimes you love life, and sometimes you despise the breath that you draw. Such was Elijah. Remember the stories of Elijah and Job. They were some of the greatest people on earth, but God still put them to a place in life where Job would say, I despise the day that I was born. I wish I was never born. You know, in the midst of Job's struggle, he said that. He would talk to God. He'd be angry. He'd shout at God. He said, God, why did you put me upon this earth? I wish I was never born. He started out in life being the richest, wisest, greatest man in all of the land, Scripture teaches us. He was the greatest man, the most admired, and God brought him down to nothing. And he said, God, why was I even born? I cursed the day that I came from my mother's womb. But God didn't leave him there, because you got to go to the end of the story. And the end of the story, God redeems him. God validates him. God said, I had to bring you through this, Job. I had to bring it through it. But the end of the Job, it says that the end part of his life was better than the beginning part of his life. So if he was the richest, famous, best guy in the world, how do you get better than that? I don't know. But it says the end of his life was better than the end. The end of his life was better than the beginning. And I love, if you know the story, it says even in the end of Job, it says that when he was in his struggle, it said all of his friends left him. But at the end of it, it says all of his friends returned to him. And he wasn't like us arrogant idiots where it says, oh, no, now you're going to come to my house. No, he understood the sovereignty of God, that God somehow caused them to forsake him. Like, he knew it wasn't their hearts. It was like God's plan somehow. So at the end of the story, when all of the friends of Job came, he opened up his doors and he celebrated and he had a party. Amen, everybody. See, our lives are filled with clarity and they're filled with conclusion, with confusion. But I want us to say this, as Pastor Phil is going to elaborate more next week for the resurrection, God is going to bring us to the other side, everybody. Because there is a day after Black Saturday, and I believe it's called Resurrection Sunday. And God does all this to make you better. And I do believe for you and for me that God wants the end of your life to be better than the beginning of your life. I say that we're coming into a season where God says, I want your life to be better. I brought you through the passion of it all. But he says, have no fear, because the end of the thing is better than the beginning of the thing. Amen. And all you have to do is believe. And my question to you always is this, very simply, I say, do you believe? I pray that God would stir your hearts, that you would believe again. That you would believe again. Amen, everybody. Amen. God bless you all. May you meditate upon that this week. Amen. And may you come back, because, you know, you're going to need the ending on this one. I'm sorry. All right, God bless you. Why don't you all stand? Praise and worship team, why don't you lead us? Amen.
Amen. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. Well, thank you for that, Pastor Mike. Let us reflect on that this week, though. Amen. Amen. Let us reflect on this. But again, maybe in a different way. Yes, he died for us. There's no doubt, and he went through it all. But it was so that we could be set free. And I pray that God would allow us to be free this week. Amen. To be free, to pursue him, to find him, to hear him, to love him. I pray he do all that this week through the ups and downs, right? Didn't Jesus Christ say, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Don't rest in the highs. Don't give up in the lows. What do? Just keep on keeping on, church. Didn't he say that? That we're supposed to press on towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. We got to press on, press on, press on. Amen. Do it with passion. Do it with conviction. Through it all. Amen. Amen. Let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we are grateful, Lord God. And yes, we are grateful for the passion, Lord God. Let the passion be ignited again in each and every one of us, Lord God. That we would always pursue you, always, Lord. Through all the ups and downs in life, Lord, we would still pursue you. We would pursue your love and your faith and your goodness, Lord God. So we thank you, Lord God, for all that you are doing, Lord God, for all those that are here and online today, Lord. We pray your blessings on us all, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.